Now, let us talk about state immunity. Article 16, Section 3. The state may not be sued without its consent. Okay? Ang sabi ng Korte Suprema, since 1993, at tinignan ko yung mga bagong jurisprudence, hindi naman nagbabago, that is called the royal prerogative of dishonesty. Why? Papasok ka sa kontrata, papasok ka sa transaksyon, hindi ka naman pala pwedeng idemanda. O, bakit? May immunity ka eh. Okay? What's the reason for the immunity? Well, considering the litigious nature of the Filipinos, ay baka hindi na makagalaw ang gobyerno, haharapin na lang katakot-takot na demanda. Di ba? O, sayang ang oras at panahon. Now, under the doctrine of par and parem non habet imperium or equality of all states, diplomats and diplomatic missions also enjoy immunity against local jurisdiction. Okay? So, anong ibig sabihin nito? Yung mga diplomats under the 1961 Vienna Convention on Diplomatic Relations, yan yung tinatawag na immunity of all diplomats and diplomatic personnel. Now, there are exceptions under Article 31. Kung babasahin nyo yung buong Article 31, there are three. Eh? Yan, lahat yan magsasabi na para magkaroon ng immunity from suit yung diplomat, yung transaction niya ay work-related. In other words, official transaction. So kung hindi official transaction yan, the diplomat cannot invoke diplomatic immunity. Okay? In the latest jurisprudence, ito yung kaso ni Westfall versus Loxin. Huh? Ang sabi dyan, they enjoy immunity only if they are exercising or performing their official capacity. Immunity does not apply to their private acts, crimes, and those acts contrary to law. Okay? So nagsimula pa yan dun sa 2000 case ng Liang versus People. Until this year, yan minimaintain ng Korte Suprema kasi yan naman nakalagay dun sa Vienna Convention on Diplomatic Relations, particularly Article 31. Huwag kayo malilito kasi pag binasa niyo yan, may Vienna Convention on Diplomatic Relations, may Vienna Convention on Consular Relations. Magkaiba yon. Ito pinag-uusapan natin, diplomatic relations. By the way, 1963, yung consular relations. Ano? Now, it was asked in the 2013 bar exam. Napakahaba ng facts. At ito yung tanong. Okay? If you are confronted with that kind of question, the first thing you do, you read the question first. Do not read the facts first. Why? If you read the facts without knowing the question, when you reach the question, you would go back to the facts. Unless you have memorized the facts. Sino mayroong photographic memory para ma-memorize yan at di niya nababalikan? So, sayang yung oras. Remember, you're under time pressure in the bar exam or any exam. Under time pressure yan. Okay? So, anong gagawin? Basahin muna yung tanong so that when you read the facts, you know what you are looking for. Madaling hanapin ang isang bagay o tao kung alam mo kung ano ang hinahanap mo. Mahirap hanapin pag di mo alam kung ano hinahanap mo. Ha? Kaya siguro hindi ka pa nakakatagpo kasi hindi mo pa alam kung ano hinahanap mo. Okay? So, ang sagot dito o ang issue dito, may immunity ba from suit? Yung ambassador. Ang sagot, meron. That was the ruling of the court in 2003 in that case of Republic of Indonesia versus Vinsons. Oh, so, after 10 years, saka itinanong. Di ba? But, remember that immunity is not absolute. Sabi ng Korte Suprema, ano nakalagay sa Constitution? The state may not be sued without its consent. Therefore, kailangan may consent para siya ay ma-idemanda. So, it's not an absolute immunity. Diba? Now, how can the state waive its immunity? Number one, by express consent. Ay, may consent naman daw yan. Okay? Express consent is given by the state either through a general law katulad ng Republic, anong Act number 3083, that's the Auditing Act, and a special law created by Congress. Okay? So, yan ay express consent. Pwede mo siya demanda. Sabi ng batas eh. Meron namang, ito is consent under a special law, never mind that. Ha? Nasira. There is also implied consent. There are two ways in which the state may give implied consent. Kailan yon? When the state commences litigation. Ang estado mismo ang nagdemanda. Therefore, kung nagdemanda siya, it is opening itself to a countersuit. Diba? Hindi po pwedeng ikaw lang magdemanda, madidemanda ka rin eh. Oh. Pangalawa, when the state enters into a contract. Correct? So yan din ang sabi ng Korte Suprema in 1954 and in 1996 as regards implied consent. Why? When the state commences litigation, it goes down to the level of an ordinary mortal. Okay? Therefore, it is opening itself to a countersuit. Now, there is also implied consent when the state enters into a contract. But take note that not every contract in which the state enters into would give a waiver of immunity from suit. Why? Kasi you have to distinguish what kind of contract is it. If it is iure imperii or sovereign and governmental acts, the state is not waiving its immunity. Katulad nung pumasok ang DPWH sa isang kontrata sa pagtatayo ng isang highway. Yung picture na yan ay pinicturan ko yan kahit na napaka-traffic sa Commonwealth Avenue kasi kakaiba, di ba? Erection ongoing. Hanggang kailan kaya yan? Yung pala, nag-e-erect sila ng mga poste na gagawin ng LRT. That's governmental acts. That's for the welfare of the public. Now, immunity is waived when the state enters into a private, commercial, or proprietary contract. Okay? Negosyo. At hindi para sa tao. Oh. The state may be said to have descended to the level of an ordinary mortal. Di ba? Kasi pumasok kasi isang ordinaryong kontrata, so pwede ka nang madimanda. Take note of that. Ha? Hindi porke pumasok sa kontrata ang Estado, pwede mo nang idemanda. No? But remember that suability does not mean liability. Okay? Oh, when the state waived its immunity or consented to be sued, it is just giving the party the opportunity to prove that the state is liable. But it does not mean that the state is liable. You still have to prove the liability. Okay? Now, how do we know that the suit is deemed against the state? The suit is deemed against the state when the Republic is sued by its name. Bawa, Silverio versus Republic. Di ba? Republic versus Antigang Bayan. Now, the suit is against an unincorporated government agency like the Department of Health, Department of Education. Unincorporated yung mga yan. The suit on its face is against a government officer. But at the end of the day, the liability will belong to the state because the officer is performing his or her official function. Okay? So in line with the his or her duty, nagkaroon ng liability, so hindi niya personal. He was acting on behalf of the state. So the suit is against the state. Okay? Now, there is a reminder from the court that the immunity from suit by the state cannot be used to institutionalize irresponsibility. Diba? Why? Public office is a public trust. Pinagtiwalaan kayo ng tao eh. Okay? Now, on the issue of separation of powers, remember, there are three grand branches of the government. Article 6, that's legislative, the power to create laws, alter the laws, etc. Amend the laws, modify them. Article 7, Executive, that's the power to enforce the law, implement the law. Article 8, judicial, that's the power to interpret the Constitution and the law. These branches are exclusive and supreme in their own spheres of influence. Our governmental structure rests on the principle of separation of powers. Diba? At yan na yung diniscuss ko sa inyo kanina. Now, there may be violation of the separation of powers when there is interference with. Ha? Nakikialam. O yung, nung panahon ng 1973 Constitution, the President had the power to legislate. Even if there was already that National Assembly, yung batasang pambansa, the President was still empowered to create presidential decrees. That's interference. Diba? Now, when the President tells Congress, enact this law, is that interference? May not be interference at all. It may be influence, but not interference. Diba? And assumption of another department's function. Oh, when the Supreme Court legislates in the guise of interpreting the law, then that might be assumption of the power of another branch. That's called judicial legislation. That's not allowed. Diba? Because the duty of the court is to interpret the law and not make the law. Kaya bawal yung mga assuming. Yung mga assuming na sasaktan. Diba? Now, although they are separate, there is that principle of checks and balance. For example, the executive can check the legislative. Diba? Paano yan? Sa enactment of the laws. By vetoing the bill submitted to the president. Okay? That balances the power of Congress to legislate. Congress can check and balance the power of the president on budgetary matters. That's why pag naghingi ka ng confidential fund, ay hindi ma-reveal kung ano yung kasi confidential. So, pupunta sila sa Korte Suprema para ipa-interpret. Tama ho ba na manghingi ng confidential fund ang isang ahensya ng gobyerno na hindi naman involved sa peace and security? Diba? Bakit nga ba hindi involved sa peace and security? Vice President. Yung mga nakaraang Vice President, di ko naman alam na nanghingi ng confidential fund. O baka hindi nabalita. Pero imposible, hindi mababalita yon. Diba? Now, there's also that blending of powers that's needed because of the complexities of modern or rapidly developing society. Abay, 1927 pa yan, rapidly developing na. Eh, ano pa ngayon? Diba? So, Congress enacts a bill. The President approves it. The President prepares the budget. Congress approves the budget. The President enters into a treaty with foreign countries. The Senate, by a vote of at least two-thirds of its members, ratifies the same. And the Supreme Court is there to declare whether or not the treaty is constitutional. Diba? As in the case of Bayan versus Zamora. Okay? Now, our governmental structure according to the Supreme Court rests on the principle of separation of powers, yet in reality, they are not really separate. Okay? Because they still blend with each other. Diba? Merong pag-aasahan. They are not totally independent. They are interdependent with each other. Okay? Now, who has the power? Sabi natin doon sa Constitution, sovereignty resides in the people. But since we are in a republican or representative democracy, the people delegated such power to the government, to the legislature. Okay? So, ang prinsipyo, potestas delegata non delegare potest. What has been delegated can no longer be delegated. O, ano ba ang dinelegate ng tao? Yung kapangyarihan. Nasa gobyerno na. So, ang gobyerno, hindi na pwedeng i-delegate yan. Okay? Now, yan ang sabi ng Korte Suprema. The rule on non-delegation of legislative power flows from the ethical principle. that such power was already delegated by the people. Okay? That was also the ruling in Rodrigo v. Sandigambayan. But there are instances when Congress may delegate a certain portion of its power. Because through delegation, Congress may devote more time to address other pressing matters. Example, ha, mamaya titingnan natin yung mga example ng delegation. Ano? Kasi kung Kongreso ang gagawa, napakarami nilang trabaho. Biruin mo, naka-recess sila ngayon. Magsisimula pa ang trabaho nila on the 4th Monday of July when the President delivers his SONA. Ano ba yung SONA? Statements of No Accomplishments. Okay? And hindi naman. State of the Nation Address. Okay? Now, what are the types of delegation? Number one, contingent legislation. And number two, subordinate legislation. How do they differ from each other? Huh? When Congress undertakes contingent legislation, it delegates to another body the power to ascertain facts necessary to bring the law into actual operation. Di ba? So gagawa siya ng isang body para gawin yung bagay na dapat gawin. For example, gustong malaman ng Kongreso ano ba talaga ang estado ng ating edukasyon, nag-create siya ng Congressional Commission on Education, nicknamed EDCOM. Meron ng EDCOM 2 ngayon. Okay? Now, when Congress creates an administrative body, it delegates subordinate legislation. Paano yon? In order for that government or administrative body to carry out its delegated function. Kasi, paano siya makapag-function kung wala siyang kapangyarihan na mag-legislate, rulemaking power ang tawag dyan, ha? O kaya mag-adjudicate yung quasi-judicial power. Oh, as may be provided by law, delegating such powers from Congress. So kaya, ito yung mga exceptions. Ha? Oh. Number one, the people. Bakit? Eh, atin yan eh. So, nireserba natin. Ha? The people, through initiative and referendum, may exercise that delegated power to legislate. Okay? That's why, nung ayaw i-define ng Kongreso kung ano ang political dynasty, ha? Kasi sabi dun sa Article 2, Section 26, prohibiting political dynasty as may be defined by law. Since 1987, it's now 2024, no law has been created defining what political dynasty is. So the people may propose. Diba? That's initiative. Okay? And if there are legislation needing our approval, we can approve or reject via referendum or plebiscite if it has something to do with the Constitution. Congress may also delegate to the executive certain emergency power during state of war or national emergency. Okay? Taxing powers under Article 6, Section 28 may also be delegated to the President by Congress. Because Congress has the power to tax. Diba? Congress may delegate to an administrative body certain rulemaking power and law executing power. At saka yung quasi-judicial. Bakit? Nag-a-adjudicate yan eh. So may adjudicatory power yan. That's why, in the case of Belhica versus Ochoa, the grant of rulemaking power to administrative agency is a relaxation of the principle of separation of powers. Why? Ang administrative body under yan ng executive eh. Diba? But when Congress delegates certain rulemaking power, aba eh nagkakaroon ka ng subordinate legislation. It may not be a law because it is applicable for a specific purpose, yet it is power, the power of Congress to legislate. So, dinelegate niya. Okay? At number, o panghuli, yung local governments. Di ba? Under the Local Government Code, and under the Constitution, Article 10, legislative power may be delegated to local government units through their legislative assembly or sanggunian. That's why, yung aming namayapang profesor na si Professor Sandoval, Edwin Sandoval, ang acronym na dyan ay PETAL, People, Executive, Taxing, Administrative, and Local Government Units. Diba, mahilig kayo sa mga acronym. Kaya minsan yung acronym na natandaan, di na alam kung ano yun. Now, in the 2016 bar exam, tinanong, explain the completeness test and sufficient standard test. In the case of KMU versus Aquino, these are the tests to determine whether the delegation made by Congress is valid. Okay? So, ano yung completeness test? In that same case of KMU versus Aquino, to determine completeness, the law must have all the terms and provisions. Complete. And leave nothing to the delegate except to implement. What only can be delegated is not the discretion to determine what the law shall be, but the discretion to determine how the law shall be enforced. Okay? So, hindi na yung ano ba itong batas na ito, kundi paano namin ipatutupad? And you have sufficient standard test. Ano ba yung sufficient standard? These are the guidelines or limitations. Diba? That the delegate has to abide by in order for its delegated power to be valid. Its delegated power to be valid. That's why when Congress created Republic Act 7722, what's that? That's the law that created the Commission on Higher Education. Okay? So Congress became a regulatory body of all higher institutions of learning in the country, colleges, universities. There was a time in 2006 that Congress, or that the CHED, wanted to regulate and supervise all private review centers in the country. So the members of Review Centers Association of the Philippines, or RECAP, went to the Supreme Court, challenged it, and the Supreme Court said, it is not within your power to regulate the review centers in the country. Limitado yung Republic Act 7722 to colleges, universities. Walang wordings doon na sinabi na pwede nyo i-regulate ang mga review centers. So yan yung sufficient standard. Diba? Hanggang doon ka lang. Otherwise, baka lumagpas. Ang sabi dito ng KMU versus Aquino, taken from other old cases, to prevent the delegation from running riot. Baka magkagulo nga naman. Diba? And this test must both be present. Okay? Hindi po pwedeng isa lang. Dapat pareho silang naririyan for the delegated power of Congress to be valid. Okay. So if you are a state, you enjoy inherent powers. And these are police power, taxation, and the power of eminent domain. These are inherent powers of the state, and you do not need any legislation for the state to enjoy this. Okay, what about police power? It is the most comprehensive, least limitable, all-encompassing of all the powers of the state. It may regulate rights and liberty for the promotion of the common good. Diba? So, who may exercise police power? It is the national legislature or Congress. Okay? So, Congress is the only one that can exercise police power. Police power is different from the power of the police. Okay? So, what is the scope of police power? Police power is so comprehensive. It can cover almost all matters affecting the health, safety, peace, order, morals, comfort, convenience of the community. It is a regulatory power. Diba? Police power is plenary, meaning all-encompassing, walang limitasyon. Only based on the principle of salus populi et suprema lex. The welfare of the people is the supreme law. And what are the elements of police power? There are two essential elements. One, imposition of restraint. Di ba? Kasi regulatory, so may restraint, may control. And second, it is exercised for the benefit of the common good. Not for the benefit of the few, but for the benefit of everyone. Now, local government units do not possess police power. This police power is delegated to the local government units. And the local government units can only exercise this police power through the respective legislative bodies. Ang gunian? Sa anong paraan? Sa pamagitan ng paggawa ng mga ordinansa, pagpasa ng mga ordinansa. So what are the tests of a valid ordinance passed by the legislative body of the local government units? Number one, they must not contravene the law or the constitution. They must not be unfair or oppressive. They must not be partial or discriminatory. They must not prohibit but may regulate trade. So hindi pwede ang prohibition, pwede regulation. Must be general and consistent with public policy and must not be unreasonable. Diba? So these tests were taken from that old case of Tatel versus Birak, Catanduanes. Okay? Eh ganyan naman tayo, diba? Na kahit na matanda na yung desisyon, na may mga 1900 pa tayong desisyon, kung hindi naman binabago ng Korte Suprema the same doctrine, there's no use using a new case. Diba? Okay. Now, take note ng MMDA ay walang police power. There's no syllable in Republic Act 7924 that grants MMDA the police power, let alone legislative power. So, paano pinapatupad ng MMDA yung kanyang mga programa? Through the Metro Manila Mayor's Council. Kasi alam nyo, kakaiba ang Metro Manila, this is the only region in the country na walang probinsya. Diba? All other regions, including the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region and Muslim Mindanao, provinces and cities yan eh. In Metro Manila, 16 cities only and one municipality. Malaki mga city, ano? Ay mas maliit daw dun sa, may mas malaki pa ba sa city? Anong tawag? Utso daw eh. So sa issue, maliit. Okay? And then, joke lang yan. So ngayon, ang MMDA, coordinating body. So paano niya ipapatupad yung mga programa niya? Through the Mayor's Council. Okay? Which in effect, delegated din naman yun ng Kongreso. Oh, maliwanag. But MMDA in itself has no police power. So hindi siya po pwedeng gumawa ng policy na hindi inaaprubahan ng mga local government units. Kakaiba, hindi ba? Yan ang problema natin sa Metro Manila. Okay, what about the power of eminent domain? Private property shall not be taken for public use without just compensation. Hindi natin alam kung bakit napunta yan doon sa Article 3, Section 9. But anyway, right kasi ito eh. Eminent domain is also called expropriation or sometimes condemnation. There are two procedures under Rule 67 of the Rules of Court. First, condemnation, when the government takes over the private property for public use. And second, the ascertainment of just compensation. Those are the procedures for expropriation under the rules of court. Now, there is a new law, okay, amending the old Right-of-Way Act, Republic Act 10752. The government may acquire real property needed as right-of-way site for national government infrastructure para mapabilis, okay? Yung lumang batas na sinasabi ko ay yung Republic Act 8974. Repealed na yan by Republic Act 10752. At dito, pagka national government project, hindi yung Rule 67 ang susundin. Ang susundin nyo ay yung Republic Act 10752 that if you want to expropriate a private property, of course for public use, you have to deposit either to the owner or to the court. I-tender nyo kung ayaw ng owner. Yung 100% of the value, zonal value ito, of the property for not more than 3 years prior to the filing of the complaint. Para saan yan? Para ma-issuehan kayo ng korte ng writ of possession so that you could start the national government project. Kasi, sa Rule 67, ang requirement lang ay 10%. But under Republic Act 10752, 100%. Okay? Now, dahil nga na supersede na ng 10752 yung 8974, which superseded also Rule 67 in so far as national government projects are concerned. Okay? But take note, the court reminds the government as its and its agencies that it is neither at its that it is their obligation to immediately initiate eminent domain proceedings whenever they intend to take private property for public use, which includes payment of the provisional value thereof, which is the 100% deposit of the zonal value for not more than 3 years prior to the expropriation. Okay? That's why, nung ang gobyerno gustong i-take over ang Terminal 3 ng NAIA, after Piatco constructed it, Judge Gingoyon ruled that you cannot take over that using police power. You have to use eminent domain. Okay? At magkano yung computation? And his decision was affirmed by the Supreme Court on December 19, 2005. 3 billion ang pinababayaran para ang DOTC at that time, Department of Transportation and Communication, could effectively take over the operation of NAIA Terminal 3. And on December 31, 2005, habang nakabakasyon itong si Judge, lalabas sa bahay niya, pinagbabaril ng dalawang riding in tandem. Okay? And until now, I think, hindi pa alam kung sino ang pumatay. Ha? Ayan. So, who may exercise the power of eminent domain? Of course, Congress. But, it may be delegated to the President, the lawmaking bodies of the LGU, yung sanggunian, public corporation, and quasi-public corporations. Okay? Because local government units have no inherent power of eminent domain. This power of eminent domain is delegated by virtue of Republic Act 7160, the Local Government Code. Okay? So how should the LGU exercise the power of eminent domain? It must enact an ordinance. Eh, sino ba nag-i-enact ng ordinance? Eh, di yung Legislative Council. It is exercised for public use. You have to pay just compensation to the owner and there must be a definite and valid offer made to the owner previously. Okay? So what are the limitations on the power of eminent domain of the local government units? That no person shall be deprived of life, liberty, or property without due process of law, nor any person be denied the equal protection of the law. That's Article 3, Section 1 of your Constitution. And the private property must be taken for public use and payment of just compensation. Now, ano ba yung taking? Taking means the expropriator must enter the private property. The entry must be not be for more than a momentary period. So, dapat forever. The entry must be under the warrant or color of authority. Hindi po pwede yung unauthorized entry. Diba? The property must be devoted to public use, not private use. And the property, the use, must deprive the owner of the beneficial enjoyment of the property. So yan ang taking as early as 1974 at di naman binago ng korte. Now in the case of City of Manila versus Laguio, there are two kinds of taking. Walang kinalaman yung picture. One is possessory taking. That's the traditional. When the government takes over the private property, converts that into public use, and pays just compensation. Now, there is a new kind of taking. That's regulatory taking. The government does not take over the property for public use, but the government issues very strict regulation. Thus, as a result, depriving the owner of the private property, the economically beneficial use of his property because of the strict regulation. That's regulatory taking. Ano bang issue dito? Kasi gustong ipasara ng City Council ng Maynila ang mga nightclub, massage clinic, hindi ko alam kung may nagpapagamot dyan, at yung mga houses of ill reputes daw. Okay? Eh, police power ang gagamitin. Sabi ng Korte Suprema at sabi ni Judge Laguio, police power regulates. It does not prohibit trade. Kung ipapasara ninyo without violation, kasi walang pinili eh. Lahat nalang ipapasara. Ha? Kasi daw, to uplift the morals of the people of Manila. Okay? Ay di lahat ipapasara. Eh may mga permit naman ito. In the first place, ba't yung inisyuhan ng permit? Diba? Yung mga nightclub, yung mga beer house na yan. Ha? Eh ba't yung inisyuhan ng permit? Ngayon, wala namang violation, ipapasara nyo, you cannot use police power there. And the Supreme Court sustained that ruling. So kaya dun lumabas yung dalawang uri ng taking. By issuing very stringent or strict regulation, you are depriving the private property owner of the beneficial use, economically beneficial use of his property, then that's regulatory taking. In other words, magbabayad ka pa rin. Abay, swerte nila. Diba? Hindi ginagamit ng gobyerno, pinasarado lang ba, bayaran siya. O, gusto nyo ba yun? Okay, hindi tinuloy yan eh. Now, in the case of Manapat versus Court of Appeals, when a private land is taken over by the government after paying just compensation for socialized housing, that falls within the category, excuse me, of public use. Excuse me po. Diba? Public use. Why? Socialized housing. Kasi yan ang ginagawa nung Office of the Urban Poor, no? Na kapag ka merong mga informal settlers sa isang lugar, kinakausap yung may-ari ng lupa, baka gusto mong ibenta na lang for socialized housing, ha, para hindi ka naman problema sa pag-demolish niyan. O kasi kakasuhan mo pa yan eh. Okay? Now, after expropriation o private property, ginamit for public use, then later on, gustong i-convert into private use, the court said, no, you cannot do that. After expropriation, it becomes property for public use, that public use must remain. Regardless kung i-convert mo sa ibang gamit, but still, public use. You cannot convert that into private use anymore. Why? There's that tendency na maabuso yan eh. There's a tendency of circumventing that rule. Kung pwede naman pala itong i-convert into private use again after expropriation. Okay? So what is just compensation? According to the Supreme Court, just compensation is qualified by the word just to convey the meaning that it must be real, substantial, full, and fair. Okay? When do you determine just compensation? It is determined at the time of the taking of property or filing of the complaint, whichever comes first. Diba? Kasi pwede naman kayo magkasundo eh. Sabi ni Judge Gingoyon, just compensation can be agreed upon. Anong basis? Fair market value. It is the price that the seller is willing to sell without being compelled and the buyer is willing to buy without being compelled. Diba? So if you cannot agree how much is fair market value, then that's the time you go to court and tell the court to determine how much is fair market value for that property. Okay? Now, and we have the last inherent power, the power of taxation, the purpose of which is to generate revenue. Kasi kung walang tax, walang gagastusin ang gobyerno. Diba? That's why if you are claiming that you are exempt from taxation, we apply the principle of constructing it in strictissimi juris. Strictly against the taxpayer claiming exemption and liberally in favor of the taxing authority. Now, who may exercise the power of taxation? Just like the two other inherent powers of the state, it is lodged in the legislature. But the legislative body may delegate that to the lawmaking bodies of the local government units. Diba? And to some extent, under Section 28, Article 6, it may be delegated to the President, as already mentioned earlier. Okay? So, it is through Congress. Now, taxation is a tool to realize social justice. Why? How do you define social justice? Naku, pagkahaba-haba nung Kalalang versus Williams, hindi ba? Oh. But how do we realize social justice? By taxation. It is realized when the government taxes a particular product, eh, and the proceeds will be used for the welfare of a particular sector. Take a look at the sin taxes. Ano ba yung sin taxes? Ito yung tax doon sa mga sin products like cigarettes, alcohol, etc. Diba? So, tinatax yan. Now, a portion of which under Republic Act 11228 goes to the PhilHealth coverage of unemployed PWDs. Okay? Kasi mga PWD na mayroong trabaho, may PhilHealth coverage. Health insurance yan, hindi ba? Yung walang trabaho, wala silang PhilHealth. So, covered na rin sila. Pero saan manggagaling yung kanilang contribution? Eh, wala nga silang trabaho eh. So, doon manggagaling a portion of the collected taxes from the sin products. So, that's how to realize social justice by taxation. And remember, according to Chief Justice John Marshall, the power to tax includes the power to destroy. Oh, di ba? That's the reality. Kasi that's an attribute of sovereignty. Pagka state ka, pwede ka mag-tax. Eh, walang pambayad na pera, kunin mo yung property. Di ba? So, ganun ang literal na rendition yan eh. Pero yung mga ayaw magbayad ng buwis, anong sabi nila? Ay mas pinaniwalaan yung dissenting opinion ni Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes that the power to tax is not the power to destroy while this court sits. It's soothing to the ears. Masarap pakinggan. Pero that is just a dissenting opinion. So there's no point harmonizing them. Because one is the decision of the majority, the other is a dissenting opinion. And these are decisions of the U.S. Supreme Court. Diba? Kaya lang, at the time, 1928, we were still a colony of the United States. Kaya sila relevant noon. Ngayon ba, relevant pa ba yan? Oo, kasi maraming desisyon naman ng Korte Suprema natin, eh halaw o galing sa mga desisyon ng Supreme Court ng Amerika. O, diba? Ayan. And ano naman ang inherent limitation on the power of the government to tax? It must be for public purpose. It cannot be delegated unless authorized by the Constitution, territoriality or situs of taxation, and government is exempt from taxation. Kaya nga, nung yung mga establishments ng Makati ay napunta na ang address sa Taguig, natatakot yung mga tao, baka singilin tayo ng tax ng Taguig. Ay, hindi pwede. Government agency tayo, hindi tayo pwedeng singilin ng tax. Diba? And international committee. Yung kaso ni Manny Pacquiao na tax evasion dati, kung naalala pa ninyo, hindi daw kasi siya nagbayad ng tax sa Pilipinas, eh sabi ng mga abogado ni Pacquiao, eh nagbayad na kami sa Amerika, di ba mayroon tayong international committee, may treaty tayo, na yung tax na binayaran doon can be credited here. Otherwise, eh baka magkaroon ng double taxation. Teka, ano ba ang double taxation? Double taxation are taxes laid on the same subject by the same taxing jurisdiction. So kung Amerika at Pilipinas, ay hindi, double taxation yan. During the same taxing period for the same purpose. O bawal ba talaga ang double taxation? Well, generally, double taxation is not forbidden. Diba? Hindi ito katulad ng prutas na kinain ni Eva at ni Adan na forbidden. Double taxation, as a general rule, is not forbidden. Double taxation becomes obnoxious, therefore forbidden, only where the taxpayer is taxed twice, unless Korean kayo, magandang girl group daw yan, for the benefit of the same governmental entity, or by the same jurisdiction, for the same purpose, but in a case where one tax is imposed by the state, and the other by the city or municipality, then there is no double taxation. Magkaiba yung taxing authority. Diba? Yan ang problema natin, kasi may national tax ka, may local tax ka pa. Eh, wala tayong magagawa because that is the lifeblood of the nation. Ang tao, tanggalan mo ng dugo, mamamatay yan. In the same manner that if you remove taxation from the government will soon die. Bakit? Eh, sa dami ng ginagastos ng gobyerno eh. May news kanina, no? na yung kakainin lang daw sa SONA ay 20 million. Hala, ano, kakain kayo ng ginto? Diba? Kung totoo yun, na 20 million yung budget para sa food, anong klaseng pagkain yan? Diba? Kasi may mga food na nilalagyan ng ginto, diba? Oh, e baka naman yun ang kakainin nyo. Huwag naman. Kasi naghihirap ang bayan.